17,000 years, the 50-mile area around Macon has been continually inhabited, the longest continually inhabited spot on the North American continent. Various Native American civilizations and cultures occupied this area for over 16,000 of those years. From the Paleo through the Archaic and Woodland periods to the early and late Mississippian civilizations, cultures have developed over time. Cultural changes occurred gradually in some cases, but drastically and catastrophically in other cases, such as during and after European contact. Since the advent of the woodwind instrument and the development of the drum as an expression of communication, there is no doubt music has played an integral role in the cultural evolution of Macon. Culture's music speaks volumes about its people. It transcends language barriers, relays traditions and customs, and can even serve to bridge cultural gaps and even ameliorate cultural differences. Following the cultural clash that resulted in the expulsion of all Native Americans in the early 19th century from Georgia, another collision course loomed on the horizon in the Macon area. The institution of slavery had introduced the components of West African cultures into the predominantly European cultures of the southern United States. Among these components were the religious customs of both cultures, as well as the regional musical influences. There was a blend and an appreciation of the cultural diversity of the cultural contact after slavery was abolished, until the practice of legalized segregation was introduced in the late 19th century and socially ingrained in the first six decades of the 20th century. Macon's central location in the Deep South, along with its prominence of ethnic diversity, made it a fertile development area for various musical genres. Among these genres were the emerging sounds of country and western music, along with music handed down from former slaves in their field songs and religious hymns, that evolved into what we recognize as gospel, blues, R&B, and soul music. Some of the foremost progenitors of this gospel and blues fusion were the street preachers in the South, and Macon's musical history includes what is possibly the last and one of the greatest of these musical pioneers, Reverend Perley Brown. Reverend Brown was blind from birth and walked the streets of Macon after graduating from the Blind Academy in Macon for almost 40 years. Reverend Perley Brown figured his songs helped provide a kind of racial bonding. According to him, he said, "I pray to the Lord that we will someday see a world without strife, when all of us can live as brothers," he told a reporter in 1958. He played from Atlanta to Thomasville, but he always returned to the streets of Macon, once saying, "I like it better here." He began coming to Macon to play in the 1940s. Catching a bus in America's on Wednesdays and walking a route through downtown Macon each day as he played, a cup attached to his guitar for donations. It was here that I first met Reverend Brown as a young boy at the age of 5. Reverend Brown was my first exposure to this type of music, and I loved it, often letting go of my mother's hand to follow and listen, much to the chagrin of my mother in a large crowd. Brown gained more recognition in the 1960s. Spurred in part by his accompanying the Reverend Martin Luther King on marches during the Civil Rights Movement. Brown played a kind of blues gospel, singing spirituals in his rich baritone in what Reverend Brown always referred to as slave songs. In addition, he was the first black performer to play on the Grand Ole Opry. Just as Reverend Brown had hoped his music could promote racial bonding, it was the younger post-war generation of the 1950s, 60s, and latter part of the 20th century that began to look at the music as a cultural bridge. It was during this time that Macon exploded onto the popular music scene. My brother and I were teenagers during this period and fortunate to witness some of the greatest performers of the time that started in Macon and then went on to national and global acclaim. African-American artists such as Otis Redding, Johnny Jenkins, James Brown, Little Richard Penniman, turn popular music on its ear. Just had this undying interest. I think I quickly earned this reputation as this little white boy who loves black music. I was just infatuated by it. I didn't listen to anything else. To me, the greatest rock and roll singer of all time, and the one who still possesses the truest, purest rock and roll voice, is Little Richard. That is where rock and roll is from. The white performers tapped into what marvelously talented black performers had created. These were the pioneers that paved the way for a global cultural exchange with the British invasion and the second wave of making music in the Southern rock explosion. If music was the bridge, aside from the artist, there was a bridge builder, like Phil Walden from Macon, the promoter who discovered Otis Redding on his label Capricorn Records. In Phil Walden's words, I almost immediately saw that maybe through this music we could help change at least how my fellow Southerners felt about black musicians, and in turn maybe that would be a step towards understanding black people. I really aspired for Otis to become a community leader.
These arms are mine, they are lonely, lonely and few. Arms of mine, they are yearning.
However, with Otis Redding's untimely death in a plane crash in 1967, and Little Richard's departure to enjoy his fame on the West Coast, the heyday of Macon as a soul music center waned. It was at this point that Macon's fame as a cultural musical mecca blossomed again. This time it was the Southern rock movement that began when Mr. Walden introduced the first integrated rock band, the Allman Brothers Band. Extended the bridge, not only as a racially mixed band, but in their fusion of blues with a country flavor and a tinge of gospel. They were followed by a string of successful Southern rock bands such as Wet Willie, Marshall Tucker, Sea Level, Randall Bramlett, and the list goes on. The cultural bridge had been created, but not without the help from other quarters. Places like Grant's Lounge in Macon gave performers a place to play before integrated club crowds, a groundbreaking forum for its time. And last but not least, the H&H Restaurant, where everyone's Mama Louise Hill opened in 1959 and fed many starving musicians as well as strangers, including me, who often couldn't afford the price of a meal. She's loved by all and has been around the world with the Allman Brothers Band in tribute to her generosity to all, no matter the color.